sometimes renegades wear totally normal shoes. Why did we call this panel Renegades? Three people up here are very friendly, very approachable, have great ideas. But it's one thing to care about design, to care about design thinking and innovation when you work in an industry or with colleagues who also care about that. It's another thing when you have to spend some time explaining why design matters to your colleagues, to your industry, to the companies that you work for. And so in this panel, we have represented health, we have represented IT, and banking, three really important fields, I think we can all agree, that can benefit hugely from design, and that's what we're going to talk about. So, but the first question I want to ask you, since none of you are traditional designers, and yet design and innovation are core to the work that you're doing, and since every superhero has an origin story, I was just curious about your sort of design origin story. What was the moment when you realized that design was going to change your career, change the way you work, change the way you talk to your colleagues? Eugene, I was going to ask you if you could start.
Okay, so I think if we look at Singapore, right, we know that we have a very rapidly aging population. Now, if we look around the world, there are many countries which have a higher proportion of elderly, Hong Kong, Japan, European countries. But what's unique about us is the speed that we are aging. You know, we are doubling from 12% to 24% in about 15 years, so very fast. Right. The other thing that we realize is in terms of disease patterns. Well, in the older days, you know, you fall sick, you go to hospital, you get treated, you come out, you're well. But what we know now is with chronic disease, you go in, you get treated, you come out, you still have the chronic disease. We need to do something about it. And the way that we deliver care, we realize it has to change, right? Good old days, you know, doctor tells you what to do, you follow instructions. Doesn't really happen for chronic disease, right? So that's where we realize that we need to do things differently. We need to start looking from the users, the customers, or in our case, we call it the patient's perspective, right? What actually makes sense to them, right? What is the language they use? So if we tell them about taking medications three times a day, before, after meals, and so on, you know, we know that, and the word we use, compliance isn't there. But we realized that, you know, we really need to change the way that we have the delivery of the message and what really makes sense to the user. And I think that set us on the journey of, you know, design thinking, because very relevant, very important methods that we are looking at, very useful methodology that we can really change the lens that we look at things and come up with the solutions.
Thanks. Stefan, what led you to embrace design thinking? What point?
It's funny, I thought I had an answer to this one, but I think I only learned about the importance of design from Mauro just now. Yeah. but yeah, you know, I think, you know, if I switch that to kind of IBM, right? And everybody, you know, knows IBM for being a large technology company, right? I think very few people know that over the last 4 years we've become the largest design company in the world, yeah, with the largest number of formally trained designers actually as part of the company, yeah. And you know, I think I've adopted this in Singapore, certainly, to try to change IBM from being technology-centric to design-centric. Mm-hmm. And I don't think there's been a pivotal point in time in my career where I've understood this, but I've had the chance to work with many, many designers over time, mm-hmm. and I'm still learning, you know, every moment about the importance of design.
Great. Neal?
Yeah, I really didn't realize I was a designer or a design thinker until I found design thinking. But in fairness, looking back, you know, I started my career at 11 in computer games. And I always wondered after I did computer games why everyone would look at me slightly weird when I talk about software when I moved into different realms designing software. Because
you were designing video games.
I built them, yeah. I sold my company at 16. I retired for 15 years, but that's another story. And so the thing was, in computer games, they are the very, very best software you could ever experience. Bar none, yeah? Because guess what? You pay $100, and you pay $100 to $200, or if you're playing Civilization VI at the moment, I'm up to 500 hours. And so you pay money and time to use a piece of software. And so when I moved from software development, when I left when I was 16, I had a bit of a break of 15 years, come back to the workforce at 30, and I was designing software. I was all about, how can we make this so compelling that people want to continually engage with it? And everyone would look at me really weird. So this was back in 2000. Mm-hmm. Because I come from a background where you would make software so compelling that people would pay $100 and 100 to 500 hours to use it. And only when I started really utilizing design thinking, maybe about 6 years ago now, and then took, you know, sort of learning and then teaching design thinking, did I realize actually, you know, that was really at my core of what I've done through my life, designing aquariums, you know, software, games, hotels, bikes, it's all cool kinds
so
of stuff as well.
So the realization was that you were trying to make compelling.
I just want stuff
compelling.
To be used.
Yeah.
I want utilization. I want to create something which people want to use, mm-hmm. rather than everyone else I was working with in software at the time in the 2000 were building software that could make money. Where I was trying to build software that people would engage with and use and find useful and actually enjoyable.
Mm. If you're in an industry or a company, let's say, where the status quo isn't necessarily super warm to design thinking, what's the appropriate posture or relationship to take? Should you think of yourself as a renegade? You are an award-winning disruptor, Neal. I mean, what is the right way to think of yourself within an organization, within an industry?
I think, number one, you've got to have no career aspirations. No, seriously, you've got to go in and go, I'm never getting promoted. Make sure you get a bonus, though, but that's, you know, otherwise there's no point being there. But seriously, for me, I listen to a lot of innovators, and we talk about all these amazing tools and these structures and processes, and what a load of guff, I'm sorry. It's a sales job. It is a sales job. You've got to convince people to change behavior. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you've got to convince very highly paid executives that maybe they don't know best. Mm. Maybe that 30 year of doing that job, they're an absolute expert who get paid too much and drive Aston Martins. Well, actually, I drive an Aston Martin, but anyway. And, you know, how do you convince them? Essentially, you're saying to them, you're wrong.
Yeah.
But how do you do that over the course of 3 months? Mm. How do you do it that you build a relationship with them and you convince them actually that it's going to improve your career from moving from this position where they know best, they do all the innovation, they drive their own kind of strategy to, hey, have a look over here and then let's think about how we listen to the customer, be customer centric, do immersion, use lean startup, work with fintech companies and that. And for me, it's a sales job, really. Mm-hmm. But then it's sales plus marketing.
Right.
So sorry to ruin everyone's illusion about innovation. It's really sales and marketing.
Spoken like and a so true need, renegade.
Yeah, thank well, you. Exactly. You've got to do broad reach campaigns to get the masses involved. And then you've got to do point kind of sales to each individual executive to convince them that change is going to be beneficial to them personally, that it's going to help them get their bonus. It's going to improve the brand of their team. It's going to do better product. And ultimately, you know, it's going to increase shareholder value of the organization.
Eugene, do you agree with that? When the customer or the end user is someone who's maybe possibly sick or ailing or, you know, who's got maybe something more on the line than just their job, let's say.
Yeah, so I totally agree with Neal's point. And if you look at healthcare, you know, and I mean, if you look at healthcare, it's traditional, it's safety is a big concern, you know, and you don't want to experience too much in a hospital where you have critical events, life and death, and all that happening. And so similarly, you have the context, and on the other hand, you have the management, right, who is maybe a bit more traditional, a bit more cautious, asking you about, you know, project sustainability, scalability plan, and so on. And really, how do you get started, right? And so I think it's, you know, how we identify the space. So for us in healthcare, the big opportunity that we see is, you know, we see the shift in pattern, in disease patterns from hospital to more community-based. Then the area that we can now look at and experiment and try new things is actually out in the community. I mean, if you look at patients, 99.9% of the time they're out in the community. The time that they actually spend in hospital is very small. And so this becomes the vast opportunity that we have to try new things and you know, see what works and really where that design lands. And I think equally important is also from the management's perspective, how can we draw that box, you know, that where we can experiment and try new things, you know, sort of like a startup, you know, and really do that discovery without the traditional metrics coming in. Mm.
Stefan, IBM's design center here is almost a year old now, and it's a space where people can come and find out about what you guys can do. And what have you learned in that year about this, about how to talk to people about design and design thinking?
It's actually interesting, right? So I was going to say to the question on, you know, how do you get buy-in for design, right? We spoke earlier about, you know, you need to create some quick wins and some things that you can show off and some early results, yeah?
Shiny objects,
And I would say that, you know, for us opening the IBM studio here in MBFC last year was a physical manifestation of the importance of design, you know, to our clients as well as to our staff and to the entire organization, yeah? And we've had, you know, over 7 months now, I think about 260-odd events in there, yeah, on average two a day. And every single person coming through starts to understand the importance of design, yeah, the importance of co-creating with multidisciplinary teams, of, you know, rapid execution and design technology coming together, yeah. So it's I think that physical space as a representation of everything that you know you're preaching and that you're envisioning is hugely important.
Mm-hmm. What do you think is the best way to talk about the importance of design to people who don't necessarily live and breathe it every day, Neal? You know, Neal, I'm throwing it over to you.
Yeah, you could have sent that in the email, that question. I don't know. It's just like, just do it for God's sake.
Yeah.
You know, it's a difference between designing for yourself and designing for your customer. Mm. And so everything you do, if you don't use design thinking, you're designing for yourself. Well done. You've got a product for you. Mm-hmm. Whereas design thinking is you're actually designing for your audience. I think that's the fundamental difference. If you look at innovation historically, it's really done by kind of overpaid people, generally in a boardroom, who know best.
Yeah.
We know best. We're the bosses. Mm. And then they invent something, and that gets, you know, productized, and then out to market, and then it obviously dips a bit, and then they pump loads of money into marketing, and everyone's happy because it's slightly successful. Whereas design thinking is about for them releasing and enabling the process to come out with the outcome. So for me, that's the difference between designing for yourself and designing for your audience.
I would add to that, right? I think, you know, in the past, brand building has been a lot of push, right? And at that stage, maybe it was around the story that you want to tell, and the executive knew best and said, hey, this is the story that I want to tell, yeah? And in some ways, I think the rapid advent of technology has democratized experiences, right? And you've got social media, and people talk about what the experiences that they have. So now, all of a sudden, it's important to design for all of these people who have access to the experience at every single second of the day, yeah? Mm-hmm. And so that is where design thinking has become so much more important than just that push communication.
Yeah. Mm. We're already getting some good questions from the audience. Wei wanted to know, how do you bust through the barriers to innovation? You're all working in either highly complex or highly regulated industries. What do you recommend as a strategy for that? Eugene, do you want to?
Yeah, I suppose that's where the renegade part comes in.
I mean, is it doing trials and limited runs? Is it setting up special spaces where experimentation is okay, or is it doing a masterful sales job?
Yeah, I think for you know, healthcare is an industry, and it's still falling back on where the science is. So we'll still start with the biomedical, the psychosocial model, right? So if we look at developed countries like Singapore, chronic disease is a big issue. If we look at developing countries, maybe malaria, maybe dengue, you know, a dysentery, these might be the areas of focus that we are looking at. So I think the area that we focus on, there's still some science to it, right? There's a reason that we want to look at. I think the next step really is finding that space that we can work on. And again, it's knowing, all right, what is critical, you know, that, all right, this is life and death. This is area where we need to be safe. But where there's a lot more, where we can experiment. So I think in healthcare, you know, we find that actually in the psychosocial space, there's actually a lot that we can do for in terms of how it can impact healthcare. I'll give an example, right? A lot of our patients, after discharge from hospital, they get very good care in hospital. But when they come out, you know, go back to their homes, they carry a big bag of medication, and what they do is they keep it in the cupboard, right? And, it stays there. The packet is unopened. And when you go to their home and you ask them, why don't you take your medication, right? At first, they'll say, yes, we are taking. Then when you say, show me the bag, and, you know, they take it out of the bag. And then we might think of how do we, you know, tell them, right, instruct them. But as we go down the road, we find that, oh, okay, they are not having meals, and they're not having meals because they are socially isolated. And that's where, you know, as we have that conversations and that insights, then that's where we have the solutions coming in. So really, you know, it's looking at which perspective that we can look at, and I think there's a lot of opportunities that we can intervene and solution from.
Mm. So dovetails into a question I wanted to ask is how do you force yourself to experience the products that you're working on, the services, from the perspective of your users and your customers, which is difficult to do if you spend all day in an office knowing everything about every aspect of the thing you're working on.
Yeah.
Stefan, do you want to try to answer
that? I can take a cut at that, yeah. I think most important is to realize where your own limits are, right? I can't represent every segment that we're targeting. I can't potentially understand a large part of the audience that we're designing or working for, yeah? So I'll need to have proxies or through design thinking, engage them in the process, right? And then become a facilitator of that process, yeah? Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, an important first step is always just to realize that, you know, if you're just designing for yourself, then that's what you're doing, and you'll miss everybody else out there who's probably very different from you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's the issue. It's better to design stuff you don't like, because then you trust the process more. And so, you know, it is a process that you are, at some level, well, you are, you're disengaged from it. You're the CEO of the process. And the process must run, and it must run its course, and you should not influence it. Mm-hmm. Many times in my career, I've got too passionate about something, and I've ended up twisting it and shaping it because I like it, and I'm the boss, so we're going to do this. Whereas now, I'm more like, okay, just stand back, let the process run, do the immersion properly, you know, do the kind of innovation pieces, the idea generation, you know, and let the delivery happen without trying to get too involved in that. And it's difficult that you got a good point. The closer it is to you, then the harder it is to kind of stay back from that. I
see. Interesting. Yeah. So when you say things you don't like, you mean products that you're not necessarily inherently interested
in? Or use, Or use or utilize or have a passion about. Me in games development, I love games. Absolutely love computer games. And so I designed them for me. Thankfully, at that time in the 1980s,
it worked.
There was a lot of people like me, obviously. But now in finance, I have to be very careful, yeah, because you just have to stay back and let the process work as it should. And that's the biggest issue I see in design thinking, is people trying to dip in and add their piece into it and reshape it and change it, or say, we've done enough immersion, let's move on. And just not let the process run, or try and jump ahead, or turn up at the design thinking session with a concept in their head. You know, that actually is the biggest issue we deal with in design thinking, rather than go, right, just let the thing run. It's a factory process. You know, we put a problem in one end, we put customers in the middle, and at the end, we're going to get the perfect solution. Just let the thing run.
Yeah. How do you ensure when you're working on team that it's a meritocracy of ideas and that certain ideas aren't privileged because the person suggesting it has great taste or is the, you know, related to the CEO or whatever reasons people tend to favor ideas? How do you keep that process honest? Stefan. Do you want to?
You're
yeah. or when the client, it's a client. It's a, you know? It's a, I mean, if it's a client, it's hard to say this idea is.
We have this a lot, right? And I'm German, but I'm going to say that in Asia we find a lot of hierarchy like we have in Germany. Yeah? But we do have a lot of these situations where yes, you bring a group of customers in, and there's a natural hierarchy in the room, and people will not say something force an opinion or a strong opinion unless the CEO has kind of voiced that this is the rough direction that he likes. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so in my experience, there are two ways to break that. One is we do kind of warm-ups as we build into the kind of design thinking methodology, right? So that we start to get people into sharing a bit more openly. We start everybody to open up a bit more. That can help, but it doesn't work always. And then the second thing is just always having the user there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So if nobody's speaking up, if everybody's waiting for the CEO and the CEO is kind of saying, I'm not going to jump out on a limb because, then my guys will tell me I'm wrong. You just let the user speak. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And even if the user is not there, then you've gone out and you've done research and you bring the user into the room and you've got videos and you've got photography and quotes and you say, this is what's actually going on. And then I think you level the playing field.
Mm. That's great.
I think just on that note, you also got to watch the politics. I mean, you can't go around telling executives that they're wrong. And so, well, you can, but you won't get a bonus. So the best thing I find is say, I love your idea. Let's go get the customers in. Yeah. And then the customers tell them they're wrong. And you just try not to smile.
Yeah.
Okay. That just straight and afterwards go, wow, I thought it was a great idea. But, the customer's the one buying. Got to listen to them.
So trust the process again. A lot of multinationals have set aside funding for incubators. Our audience member, Shen, points out. What's your experience been like? Is this worthwhile way to go about testing the waters on certain ideas? I don't know what you think. You run trials, obviously.
Yeah.
Not quite an incubator, but traditionally. But how valuable is that?
Yeah, so I think the support is very important, and I think for public sector, we do get quite a lot of support from the various government agencies. But having said that, I think what's important really is the fast experimentation, right? So one project that we did was a kiosk, a seat kiosk. It's a unmanned kiosk, and one of the things that we wanted to do was try to substitute, a kiosk in place of a doctor, right? Not completely, but some of the tasks. And when we first started, right from the doctor's perspective, we say, all right, the person probably needs to use the kiosk once a year, right? But once we start talking to the users, the perspectives are quite different. They started saying, we want to use it as often as we want to, because it allows us to keep track of our health status. And so with that idea, we start doing the mock-ups, we created a cardboard version, we have paper flip charts and so on. So I think really, it's getting the idea going and having the organization and the government agency support is very important. But I think at the end of the day, equally important is having the fast experiments, and a lot of these, can be pretty low cost. It takes a lot of energy, it takes a lot of effort, but it allows us to get results quickly. Yeah, so it doesn't need to be that big experiments.
Yeah, those kiosks are amazing. People should Google them. They are a really interesting model for cutting down the waiting time in hotels.
They feel like hotels.
They do, yes. great place to read a magazine, but besides that. Let's say you have a lab or you have a design organization at your company or your division of your, wherever you work, how do you take what's happening in there and spread it throughout the rest of the organization? You guys have a very cool space. How do you get that, what's happening there, out into the rest of the world or the rest of a company?
Okay. Yeah. There's there's all the natural stuff, right? So by now everybody's on social media all the time, right? So you share photos, you share videos, right? And it spreads like wildfire when good things are happening, yeah. Usually not through the channels that you think it should spread through, but through other channels that people just use and adopt, yeah. I do think you need to prepare it in a way where it becomes appealing to be shared, which kind of goes to I think something that Mauro said also, is you need to create parts of the story that are compelling enough that people want to associate themselves with that story and kind of share it back out, to the company, whether it's to make themselves famous, to attach their own brand to that piece of work, et cetera, right? So you shape it to, here's something that could be shared, and then you let it run.
I think that's a great point about making something exciting and interesting. What we do is they have no choice. So they're actually the workers in the lab. So the workers in the lab are the staff, and they're responsible for innovation. And so rather than just a separate unit doing all the innovation at DBS, my team are basically the ones which pulls the business together to operate in that. And so then when they leave, then they spread the kind
of... I see, so they rotate?
Yes, that's right, yeah, they rotate. And it seems to work quite well.
Are your organizations, Wei Jen asks, gunning for incremental or disruptive innovation? Is one better than the other? What's the goal?
Yeah, so for all organizations, we have the main productivity component, and that will be incremental. But what my organization and a lot of the organization healthcare realized is that we really need to invest and set aside some space to look at this revolutionary and disruptive form of innovation. And we know that it's going to take time, the experiment needs to take time, and we need to start early, right? So I think acknowledging that, the main component needs to carry on, the main business continues on, but at the same time, it's really that innovation and trying out new things and how can we share it and scale it. So I think in that space, the partnerships are very important, and it's not just about working with ourselves, but we've worked with IBM, we have a design thinking workshop, we work with the grassroots organizations, the community development councils, the broad community, social networks, formal organizations. I think looking at innovating together with that broad community is really quite key in, journeying together, as we try something new.
When people are coming to you at IBM, are they tending to look for game changers or game modifiers? And is there a value in kind of explaining the limits of what to expect?
Yeah, so I think in the times that we live, we obviously we're about disruption. Yeah, it's what our clients worry about and where they need help with, and it's also where what we worry about and need help with. Yeah? And if you look at the IBM story, we're 100 years old. And the only way to survive 100 years in technology is if you continuously reinvent yourself. Yeah, and over the last 4 or 5 years, we've gone through one of those cycles, which has been very painful. We've divested large parts of the business, and we've kind of disappointed shareholders, and we've kind of realigned all of our messaging, and we're now very clear around we're a cognitive and cloud computing company. Yeah. And we've trained probably tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people on design thinking across the company, adopting that widely. Yeah, so it's clearly not incremental. It's not adding in a little piece, but it's entirely changing who we are and what we do.
Disruption versus incremental. You need a portfolio approach.
Yeah,
I see lots of innovation labs. They got these pie in the sky, and they just focus on the really disruptive. Probably a bit too early and unrealistic to get past the board, or even the customer maturity may not be there yet. So it's a portfolio. You need stuff which is going to get you fed today. You need stuff which is going to protect you in the future. But there's also a big mismatch in our industry in finance, because what we think is disruptive in finance is kind of base of the pyramid in a tech company in many ways. And so a lot of it is reshaping the staff. So actually, no, don't look at other banks. Look at IBM, look at Google, look at Microsoft, look at Amazon. Or actually, no, forget them. Go look east, Alibaba, Tencent, and others. And start to benchmark against them. And actually, something which is kind of middle of the road for a large tech organization is actually massively disruptive for the world of finance. So getting those kind of learnings from different industry.
How do you know when you're making change in the right direction versus just change for change's sake?
Your bonus goes up.
Your bonus goes up. Okay, so performance metrics.
Yeah.
What about in health? When you're working on new programs, are you sticking to outcomes? Are there other metrics for health outcomes? I mean, or are there other ways of judging what works? It's still having a job.
Yeah. No. I think when we go into a new space and you know, a lot of the traditional measures that we use aren't applicable. And sometimes that's the challenge that we face. And especially when we go upstream in health and we talk about the preventive approach, you know, we tell people exercise more, eat better, you know, it's 5-10 years later that you really see the impact, right? So I think what is important for the initial stages, is really see the adoption. You know, is it really meeting the user's needs? Are they adopting it? You know, is it making a difference for them? Right. So in terms of, for example, medication compliance, right, it might be some way down, time down before you really see the impact of the regular medication. But if we say that, okay, it's because of lack of social interaction, that's why they're not having meals and so they're not taking their medication. If we start measuring the interim steps, right, I think that's going to help. Mm. I think the second point is really taking a more qualitative approach, you know, having the interviews and having the feedbacks. And again, I think this is where the designers come in very helpful, you know, to get the additional insights. Because we tend, as professionals, to look from a, maybe a bit more scientific lens, but, you know, really getting the insight and the views of the users, that will provide the other balance that, yes, we are really making an impact and, we are making progress in the journey.
Mm, interesting. Neal, Sharon asks, speaking of disruption, how did organizing hackathons within DBS change your organization and make it different from other banks?
Yeah, thanks for that question, Sharon.
Sharon's on fire today.
Yeah, it was a real, I mean, it wasn't just hackathon, it was something a lot more complex. You know, we want to teach our top 250 leaders digital mindset, so they asked me if I got any slides. I'm like, that isn't going to change them. and so what we did a three-day event where we got them to invent their own fintech company to solve the big problems at the bank. So we took three leaders, paired them with three people from a fintech or startup, and then coached and mentored them through design thinking, experimentation, lean startup, rapid prototyping to invent their own fintech company. And they were running around shopping malls with paper prototypes. It was hilarious watching these guys in suits do that. And at the end of it, they had to pitch to the CEO. And so there was a real kind of deadline on delivery for the thing. But a lot of the things you heard was like, I just did a prototype in one day. You're like, mm-hmm. that's mm-hmm. all it takes. Yeah, but at the bank, it takes 6 months. You're like, well, that's something we need to fix. my very favorite thing through all this journey is when the executives get told they're wrong. Mm. I love that. They go out with a customer. I did 15 of these sessions so far. And they're so happy they invented something. And they're like, yeah. And I go, right, go out and test it then. They're like, yeah, this is going to be a winner. And I watch them come back in with their sad faces. And I'm like, I love this. Because the customers told them they're wrong. And that is the biggest single thing,
yeah.
Is customers saying, you're wrong.
Right.
I don't like what you've made.
And does that change the mindset of the
people? Oh, yeah. Definitely. One, it dents their ego. That creates a hole, and I think the message goes through. That's the mm-hmm. science behind that.
Interesting.
No, but it is, in fairness, you know, it's a new world for the executives. It's a new world for all of us. But you cannot argue with a customer at the end of the day. They are the ones who buy the product, buy the service, and if they say they don't like it, they don't like it.
Mm. Someone once wrote that a good design culture is an optimistic culture, and I'm just curious as the clock is clicking down here, how do you maintain a culture of optimism if you're working with a company that maybe is struggling, or if you're working with a company that's restricted by regulation, or if you're working with a population that may be dealing with long-term health effects?
Yeah, so I think a lot of it is, you know, and when we are on the ground and we are embedded on the ground and we have direct touch points with the users, and you make an impact, right, and you make a difference to their lives, and, you know, they really appreciate it, right, I think, you know, that really drives us. So while there might be a bureaucracy or whatever that's that we need to a pushback against, but you know, being able to really touch lives and make a difference, I think, you know, that really keeps us going in healthcare.
Keeping an eye on the results, Stefan, how do you stay optimistic if you're working with a client who's...
So I think there's two components to it. One is you need to have a strong vision kind of in terms of what you want to achieve and get people enlisted in that. And then the second thing is you have to help them when it's painful and hurting on the way to get there and kind of keep them on the track, yeah? But if it's, you know, if it's hurting, then you're probably doing something right in terms of changing things.
Great. Neal, how do you keep
Just don't give up, seriously. Just keep going, have a thick skin. You'll win in the end.
Great. All right, great. Well, thank you very much. Thanks, Renegades.
Yes.
Thank you.